user, for example.
Yeah. When I talk and work with entrepreneurs, I feel that they're very technical in many cases, and therefore they think about things into the details of the technical details, right? Because this is what they're dealing with. And now you're telling them, okay, when you sell the idea, even if it's someone very professional or a VC that really doesn't, they do understand the technical stuff, you still need to have this story. It's not enough to talk about the bits and bytes of things, and especially because it's sometimes changing and you're pivoting when you're starting with something, and they just want to see this potential, and to imagine a potential, it's so hard, right?
Yes, you said something great. You said imagine the potential. Because I think that the solution for that, or understanding that, first of all, it's understanding that what you said, which is the technicalities of the product or the idea are super important, but only if the person is convinced that there's potential there, that it's worth investing in it. So one way to think about it, to bring storytelling elements into that, is to describe what we like to call the world before and the world after. So it's rather than this is my product or this Waze, these are the features of Waze, but the world before is, imagine when you came to work today, maybe you got into traffic. Maybe it took you much longer than you expected. If you have to plan for a meeting, you sometimes need to go out earlier because you never know what you're going to encounter. But right. With Waze, so the world after it, with Waze, you will be able to put in the address. People will log in when there's traffic. So in real time, you'll be able to tell which way is the fastest. You'll be saving time. And you'll be able to contribute to other people's saving time. So it's already imagining, let the audience imagine what the world will look like after your solution or your idea is implemented. And then the technicalities are already just like, oh, okay, so how do you do it? Just tell me how you do it.
Yeah. And do you think that it's connected to the character of the, like, introverts, it's harder for them to speak in public or to pitch, or if they rehearse, it doesn't matter?
I don't know. I'll say I don't know. I know that, for example, in theater, you have quite a few actors who are introverts, who feel, or like there's something about being on stage sometimes, or being, or going into character, or being, or pitching, or being. Sometimes it actually brings the best out of people who otherwise are introverts. I know my brother is a super introvert, and he's a professor in the university, and his wife is like, how come you're one of the most successful professors in the university? And at home, you're like barely saying anything. So for some people, yes. Yeah. For some people, that's so. But I think it is a matter of, first of all, you even saw it yourself. It's so much a matter of experience, right?
Yeah.
It's like when people tell me that they don't like speaking, or they're shy, or they're not sure about it. Usually what I tell them is the best thing you can do is find more opportunities to speak, because that's the best way to improve. So I think that's more than character. It's that, I think, but I don't know.
But for me, I could tell you, I'm an extrovert as a person, and I like talking to people. I like talking in general.
Great. So you're in the right profession. No?
Yeah, you're right. But when I think about it, it's so different. When coming from one to many, and from doing it live and doing it online. So let's talk about like, what's the move right now? COVID crisis, everything is online, all the events, all the conferences, everything is online. So what, other than the fact that we are just having this torso and something, right? So, and I always talk with my hands.
Me too.
Many years ago, when I just started in my profession, in my business, I created a series of videos, and it was the first time that I really was caught on camera and video, and I saw myself, and I talked so much with the hands, I didn't really understand that this is what I'm doing. And one of my friends, he called me and he said, like, You're talking so much with the hands that because we're working internationally, we think it could be even a bit like it looks like intimidating for people when you talk this way in several cultures. And for me, you know, after I invested so much in these videos, that was too much.
It's very useful. Right? Feedback.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. What can I do now? And it was very surprising for me. So how do you see this? Like what you had in before everybody saw your full body more or less when you're on a stage, and right now it's so different. So what are the things people need to know when they're doing this like move in the last like 2 years?
How to adjust to this new and
remote.
Remote or hybrid.
Yeah. Hybrid is much harder, as I see, because
hybrid is the hardest. I came back like 2 months ago, traveled to Europe to go to a huge conference that they did in a firm, the whole leadership of a firm. And because they didn't want to fly everyone, they had one location in Europe, one in the US, and people in Asia, all at the same time. And with one stage that had a mirror stage in Europe and in the US, sometimes with two speakers, one from each country. Like I know. But the nice thing for the audience is that if things went wrong technically, and they obviously did because it's all new, there's something almost exciting about it. Something like being in something live that you know is raw, that you know is new, that in a way, we started off speaking about perfection, in a way that's even more attractive than if everything went smoothly. So so first of all, I think it's like embracing the imperfection of this and the fact that, I don't know if I'm allowed to say shit, but I will, shit happens. And it's okay that it happens. That's the beauty of life. But there are ways to adjust to, I've worked with TED speakers all over the world. So we've been working with Zoom since 2015 or something, one of the first users. So the transition wasn't that big, but it was big for a lot of our clients. So a few things to keep in mind, I think. One is if attention span is short in human to human in live, it's much, much shorter on virtual, much shorter. The opportunity to be distracted and look for other things is much bigger and it's much easier. So we have to think about all the time, how do we not only hook the audience at the beginning, but how do we keep them engaged? Don't be afraid to ask questions. Bring in, if you use slides, you don't just leave the slides there, but go on and off from slide sharing. So there's some dynamism. So there's something going on. Think at every moment, it's not easy, but think at every moment, what will keep your audience's attention with you rather than anything else? So that's, I think, one thing. Another thing is as far as making your meetings as short as possible. People will thank you. State the goal from the beginning. That's even more important than in person. Again, because of that attention. I have need to have a reason why I'm staying. And as far as your presence, I think one thing is to remember that to create eye contact, it's don't look at the image of the person, look at the camera, which is, it's difficult because you don't see a human, but you have to imagine a human. But on the other hand, it really creates the sense of, wow, that person is looking at me. Right. And the nice thing in virtual is you look at one place, which is the camera, and each and every person, whether it's one or 1,000, each and every person feels you're looking at them. Like the Mona Lisa, I call it the Mona Lisa effect. Yeah. So I think that if you remember those things, hook the audience, have a clear goal stated from the beginning, and really look at the camera, I think you'll be much, much ahead of most people and how they speak on virtual.